Question, does it really matter that my bracket got totally busted this year? Does that really matter? Does it really matter that you maybe got a scratch on your 10-year-old car this last week when it was parked in the parking lot? Does it really matter? Does it really matter? Very responsive today.
Very cool.
April Fool's Day, right? Does it really matter? Does it really matter if the Vikings never win the Super Bowl? How about that one?
Yeah.
No, it doesn't matter. There's so many things in life that we're really forced to ask the question, does it really matter? And some of the things are kind of, we can laugh at, some of them are kind of serious, you know? But does it really matter if our country keeps going deeper in debt? You know, if you're a student in school, does it really matter if I have name brand clothes or not? That can be a serious thing. But a lot of things in life, we're forced to ask the question, does it really matter? How about the resurrection? Does it really matter if Jesus Christ rose again from the dead? Thank you, it does. It may be that you are very familiar with the story, you understand the significance of Christ's resurrection from the dead, but perhaps you're here today and you're really not sure if it's that big of a deal. Yeah, I believe he died. I don't know, did he rise again? Maybe. Maybe not. It doesn't really matter, I don't think. As long as he died for my sin, I guess that's good enough. If we were to ask the Apostle Paul the question, does it matter if Christ rose again from the dead? He would shout yes, loudly. Yes, it really matters that Christ rose again from the dead. We're turning this morning to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And it's a passage where the Apostle Paul argues for the significance of the resurrection of Christ from the dead. And so we're going to start looking at verse 12 of that chapter and go through the beginning of verse 20, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Here's what the Apostle Paul writes. Now, if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain. Your faith also is in vain. Moreover, we are even found to be false witnesses of God, because we testified against God that he raised Christ from the dead, whom he did not raise, if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, even Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If we have hoped in Christ in this life only, we are of all men most to be pitied. But now Christ has been raised from the dead. You've got to love verse 20 and that word but. But now Christ has been raised from the dead. The Apostle Paul is the author of many of the books in the New Testament in our Bibles. And his books are really letters that he wrote to first century churches and Christians. And the one before us here today is one where Paul is writing to a church in the city of Corinth in Greece. And Paul had to argue for the significance of the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And here's why. Some of the people there had some serious doubts about the resurrection of the dead being possible. And as Paul went on to explain, if it's impossible for dead people to be raised back to life again, then by default, Christ hasn't been raised back to life again either. Okay? So here's your logic. Dead people can't come back to life again. Paul, then Christ hasn't come back to life again either. That's what they're saying. You know, some people have the same logic today. Miracles can't happen. Therefore, that miracle you're talking about it never happened, right? I think about Tom and Jean's daughter having cancer. All of a sudden, lots of Christians start praying for her. She goes back and finds out the cancer's gone. That's a miracle, folks. And yet some people today, their line of reasoning is, miracles can't happen, therefore that didn't happen either, right? If dead people can't come back to life, then Christ didn't come back to life either. That's what Paul is saying. And what Paul points out then is that if Christ has not been raised from the dead, if he's still dead, then there are some serious implications for the Christian faith. Notice first of all that if Christ has not been raised, then the gospel message is not true. Now we need to go back to the beginning of chapter 15 to get a good understanding of what the gospel message is that Paul was preaching. Okay, if Christ has not been raised, the gospel message is not true. Well, look at the first verses of chapter 15. Paul says, I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, in which also you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast to the word which I preached to you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. And then Paul goes on to describe how Jesus, after rising from the dead, appeared to all kinds of different people, to the disciples, to hundreds of other people, including Paul himself. Now notice then that the gospel message that Paul proclaimed is that Christ died for your sins, and this was in accordance with what the Old Testament scriptures prophesied would happen. He was buried. He actually died and was placed in a tomb, but then he rose again on the third day according to the scriptures. He died for our sins, but rose again in victory. And Paul is saying that that is at the heart of the gospel message. That message of good news that we proclaim to people. Christ died for your sins, but he didn't stay dead. He rose again on the third day. He rose again in victory. And Paul is saying, if Christ is still dead, then this gospel message is not true. And if you look at verses 14 and 15, Paul makes it clear that if the gospel message is not true, then preaching that message is a pointless thing to do. In other words, what I'm doing right now would be a waste of time. You guys sitting here on this Easter Sunday would be a waste of time if, in fact, Christ is still dead and I'm preaching a message that isn't even true. I mean, let's face it. What's the point of me and you devoting all kinds of time and energy to gather here today to talk about something that never really even happened? If the gospel message isn't true, then preaching that message is pointless, and those who preach that message are liars. Now, we dealt a little bit with the issue of lying in regards to the Easter story as we had the children come up and help us act out what happened with the soldiers. They were told to tell a lie, weren't they? Well, Paul is saying that if Christ is still dead, and we're running around telling people, believe in Christ, he died for your sins, and he rose again from the dead, then we're out telling a lie, aren't we? We are false witnesses against God, saying that Christ rose again, when in fact he did not. We are actually lying against God. If Christ is still dead, the gospel message is not true, preaching that message is pointless, and those who preach that message are liars. Now we can say, well, lying's not good, right? Suppose I lied to you about the weather forecast for tomorrow. By the way, it's going to be 45 and sunny. It's going to be a great day tomorrow. Okay? I might be telling the truth. I might not be. Okay? Let's say that I misled you regarding the forecast for tomorrow. You come to find out that, no, actually, it's not going to be 45 and sunny. Probably not a big deal, right? That I told you something that wasn't true. But suppose I'm up here telling you, here's how you get to heaven. And I'm telling you something that isn't true. That's a big deal, folks. And that's what Paul is pointing out here. That if Christ is still dead, and Paul knows it, and so do the others, and here they're running around telling people that he's alive and believe in him and be saved. What Paul is saying is we are leading you astray regarding the most important thing in life, the salvation of your soul. This is why it's so significant, writes Paul, that you understand that Jesus really did rise again from the dead, and that dead people really can come back to life. Of course, Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, and all kinds of people saw it. It has happened. It happened with Christ. But if Christ is still dead, then the gospel message is not true. Secondly, Paul makes it clear that if Christ is still dead in the tomb, then faith in him is worthless. Okay? According to verse 17 and 18, if faith in Christ is worthless, as he's arguing here, if Christ is dead, then we are still in our sins. That's what he says in verses 17 and 18. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless, you are still in your sins. That means that our sins have not been forgiven. It means that our sins are still being held against us. It means that we can expect nothing but God's wrath for our sins. And if God gives that to us, we'll be getting exactly what we deserve. That's what it means to still be in your sins. If Christ has not risen from the dead, if he was still dead, then he wouldn't have won the victory over sin and death, the victory that we needed him to win for us. Simply put, if we're still in our sins, then we're cruising down the highway to hell. We're in for an eternity of punishment for our sins if Christ did not rise again in victory. So, if Christ is still dead, the gospel message is not true. Believing in him is a worthless, pointless thing. And notice that it's not only for those who are still alive that Paul speaks of, but also in verse 18, he mentions those who have already died. He said, those who have already fallen asleep in Christ. He says, if they died believing in Christ, and Christ in fact is not the Savior because he didn't rise from the dead, then they died believing a lie. They are eternally lost. They died believing in something that proved to be of no benefit to them. If Christ is still dead. And to sum up the first two points, if you look at verse 19, Paul makes it clear that if Christ is still dead, then Christians are to be pitied more than all men. Have you ever felt really bad for someone? You know, maybe you're driving down the road and you see someone trying to change a tire and it's raining out. Right? Like, man, I feel bad for that guy. Right? Or maybe you're in a grocery store and you see a poor mom trying to get the items on her list and her kids are just giving her the hardest time ever. And you just feel really bad for that mom. Man, shape up, kids, right? You feel bad for the Vikings having heartbreak again and again, right? You don't know me, I'm a Packer fan. Sometimes we feel really bad for people about things. And what Paul is saying here is if Christ is still dead, and here we are believing in him as Savior, then of all the people in this world, we are the ones who should be pitied. Because here we are, believing something that isn't true. We've been tricked into believing a message regarding a guy who rose from the dead, but he didn't. Here we are, believing in a dead guy. A guy who was a big deceiver, like the chief priest pointed out to Pilate. Don't you like the way that they put it? You come to Pilate now. You remember how that deceiver said that 3 days later he'd rise again. They thought Jesus was a big phony, but he wasn't the Messiah. If Jesus is still dead and here we are believing in him, people should genuinely feel bad for us. Because we are clinging to a bunch of empty promises. And one day we're going to find out that there was nothing to any of those promises. If Christ, in fact, is still dead. But as Paul made clear, in verse 20, the truth is that Christ is alive. Which means that it's the reverse of all of these things we've been talking about here. The gospel message is true. Faith in Christ is the most valuable thing in this whole world. And we Christians are not to be pitied, because through faith in Christ we have a saving relationship with the God who created us. That's the most important thing in the world. And through faith in Christ, that is ours. But now Christ has been raised from the dead. You know, if you read the gospel accounts, it's clear. The tomb was empty and everyone knew it. No one denied that. All kinds of people saw that Jesus was alive. If Jesus actually, his body had actually been stolen, then why in the world wasn't his body produced at some point to prove to everyone, okay, yeah, this was just an April Fool's Day joke. He's actually dead. The tomb was empty. Everyone knew it. No one was denying it. That little group of disciples who were scared and fled from Christ certainly had not come to steal that body from the tomb when the soldiers were guarding it. Hundreds of people saw Jesus alive in different places and in different circumstances. It's clear that Jesus really did rise again from the dead. He's alive today. He's changing lives today. If I were to ask, has Christ changed your life? I bet you many of you could raise your hand right now. He's alive. And he's changing lives today. You see, the resurrection of Christ is really that significant. It proves that Jesus really is who he said he was. I mean, if Jesus said, I'm going to be killed and 3 days later rise again, and it didn't happen, either Jesus is a liar, or Jesus is delusional and thought that something was going to happen that never was going to happen. But he said he'd be killed and rise again after 3 days, and that's exactly what happened. He really is who he claimed to be. He really is who the Bible claims him to be. His death on the cross for the sin of the world was valid and sufficient before God. The price has been paid. And Christ rose again in victory. In victory over sin and death and the power of the devil. Does it really matter that Christ rose again? Absolutely, it does. Do you know what else really matters? If you believe. If you believe in Christ. Crucified for you and risen again in victory. Do you believe? Are you trusting in Jesus as your Savior. It's only in Him that salvation is found. If you're not, there's no better day than Easter Sunday to believe in Christ. To acknowledge before God, yes, I'm a sinner, I need your forgiveness. And I believe that Christ died for me. He rose again in victory. And the promise of Scripture can be yours then. He who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. There's no better day than Easter Sunday to come to faith in Christ. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for giving us the Bible, that we can read about how Christ died for our sins. He took the punishment that we deserve. He paid the price. Thank you that He did that for us. Thank you that He rose again in victory, proving that He really is who He claimed to be, that He is the Savior, the promised Messiah. And Father, thank you for that message of good news. Christ died for us and rose again in victory. And he who believes in Him is saved. Father, you know exactly where each one of us is at today, whether we believe or not. I pray that for those who are trusting in Christ, that you would continue to work in our hearts and in our lives, that you would ground us in our faith, and that we would grow in our appreciation for what Christ has done for us. Lord, if there are some here today who are not trusting in Christ, for whatever their reasons may be, I pray, Lord, that through the power of your word and your Holy Spirit, that even right now you would make it so clear to them how desperately they need Jesus. Remind them, Lord, of that wonderful promise. The one who calls upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ will be saved. Lord, bring us great joy as we focus on Christ, crucified and risen again. That is a joyful, wonderful message. We thank you for what you've done for us. In Jesus' name, amen.